Hello, how are you? It's Transfiguration Sunday today. I'm so excited. Yay!
Hi!
I'm Ashlyn.
I'm Zoe.
And we would like to welcome you to worship.
It's Transfiguration.
Have a great day.
We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amid the shadows of this world, let us confess our sin and welcome the light of God's forgiveness.
God of grace and truth, in Christ Jesus, you came among us as a shine light shining in the darkness. We confess that we have not welcomed the light nor trusted the good news of great joy. Forgive us and renew our hope so that we may live in the fullness of your love, trusting in the grace of Christ our Lord. Amen.
The angel said, "You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." With great joy, I announce to you the entire forgiveness of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you. the light and love of God, who wonderfully made you, who graciously redeemed you, who calls you each by name, be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, mighty and immortal, you are beyond our knowing, yet we see your glory in the face of Jesus Christ. Transform us into the likeness of your Son, who renewed our humanity so that we may share in his divinity. Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Moses came down from Mount Sinai. As he came down from the mountain with the two tablets of the covenant in his hands, Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone because he had been talking with God. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, the skin of his face was shining, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the leaders of the congregation returned to him, and Moses spoke with them. Afterwards, all the Israelites came near, and he gave them in commandment all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. When Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out. And then when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, the Israelites would see the face of Moses, that the sun of his face was shining, and Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him. The Lord is king. Let the people tremble. The Lord is enthroned upon the cherubim. Let the earth shake. The Lord, great in Zion, is high above all peoples. Let them confess God's name, which is great and awesome. God is the Holy One. O mighty King, lover of justice, you have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord and fall down before God's footstool. God is the Holy One. Moses and Aaron among your priests, and Samuel among those who call upon your name, O Lord. They called upon you, and you answered them. You spoke to them out of the pillar of cloud. They kept your testimonies and the decree that you gave them. O Lord, our God, you answered them indeed. You were a God who forgave them, who punished them for their evil deeds. Proclaim the greatness of the Lord and worship upon God's holy hill, for the Lord our God is the Holy One.
Friends, it's Psalm 99 today. It's an ecstatic song of praise and awe. It mentions the pillar of cloud in the Exodus story, and it kind of connects to the New Testament story of Jesus' baptism and Transfiguration Sunday, when we are also contemplating the glory and mystery and awe of God with us. Today's song is very quiet. Holy is this one. Got two little verses. In the wilderness, on the mountain, were you always? In the wilderness, on the mountain, were you always?
Since then, we have such a hope, we act with great boldness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But the minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the Old Covenant, that same veil is still there, since only in Christ is it set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And all of us, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. Therefore, since it is by God's mercy that we are engaged in this ministry, we do not lose heart. We have renounced the shameful things that one hides. We refuse to practice cunning or to falsify God's word. But by the open statement of the truth, we command ourselves to the conscience of everyone in the sight of God. Please stand for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel for this Transfiguration Sunday comes from Luke, the 9th chapter. Conversation about Jesus' suffering and death is enclosed in a dazzling foreshadowing of the resurrection. God affirms Jesus' identity. The disciples are stunned, speechless, and Jesus resumes his mission with a demonstration of his power over evil. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and went up the mountain to pray. While he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory, and as they were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now, Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, since they had stayed awake, but they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. They kept silent in those days and told no one of any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. Jesus then met a man from the crowd who shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He's my only child." Suddenly a spirit seizes him, and all at once he shrieks. It convulses him until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. "I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not." Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed into him to the ground in convulsions, but Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Have you ever had a mountaintop experience? One of those amazing moments where you glimpse the glory of Jesus and you have this deep sense of awe. Perhaps it was in worship, or at a retreat, or camp, or maybe it was when you were singing with other wonderful voices. Or maybe it was in the beauty of nature, you know, like on an actual mountaintop. Most of us have, and most of them aren't huge moments, just little moments of glory where we have a deep knowing about the holiness of our God and our place in the world. And these moments can change us, indeed. And today is the Transfiguration Sunday, a lesser known Christian holiday. Most people don't even care about this one. But it's an important day in the life of the church when we always hear that story of the Transfiguration, how Jesus took with him his three disciples, James and Peter and John, and up they went to the mountaintop. And there, Jesus suddenly is transfigured before them. He's glowing in this otherworldly brilliance, this dazzling light. And if that's not enough special effect for you, Moses and Elijah come back from the dead and appear with him too. And they end up talking together. And they talk about Jesus' departure with him in this moment of transfiguration. It's interesting because Jesus has just been talking with his disciples about his departure. He says, you know, this is going to end badly because I'm standing up for the right things. I am going to be crushed by Rome. They will kill me. And these guys don't like hearing that at all. They're like, "No, Jesus, that's really not the ending that we want for you. Let's not do that." But now they can see that Jesus is serious about submitting himself to this kind of suffering, because now he's discussing it with Elijah and Moses. And he says they were speaking about his departure, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. His departure, that's how it's translated here in the NRSV. But in the original Greek, it means exodus. So it's kind of interesting, isn't it, that Jesus is talking about his exodus with Moses, who led a great exodus for the people of God out of slavery in Egypt and into the promised land. And we hear about this famous exodus in the book of the Bible, also called the Exodus. In this book, we hear that long, long, arduous journey where the people of God follow in faith through so many troubles to finally reach the promised land, where then they are free people, finally free. And Moses, His mission, even though he didn't really want this mission, he was reluctant all the way till God finally convinced him. Moses' mission has always been about freedom. He led the people to freedom. So what is he doing here at the Transfiguration, do you wonder? Perhaps Moses' presence here represents freedom, the true freedom that God offers. And then there's Elijah there too, the great prophet, so famous indeed that he did not die, and he was said to have been taken away from earth in a whirlwind accompanied by a fiery chariot. So if you gotta go, that's the way to go in style. He has a deathless death. So what's Elijah doing at the Transfiguration? Perhaps he is representing the power of God that is so great, it's death-defying. From start to finish, Luke's gospel is all about liberation and new life. And Luke shows us again and again that Jesus is the one who has come to bring this. At his very first sermon at his hometown in Nazareth, he quotes from Isaiah, that beautiful scripture that said, God will set at liberty those who are oppressed. And he says, my mission is fulfilled in your hearing, declaring, that's what I'm here to do. I am the one who's going to bring liberation to all the world. So what do we do with this story? It's a nice story, isn't it? We hear it every year, but it's difficult to understand. Look, Peter was right there, and he didn't understand it. He misunderstands altogether. He likes the Transfiguration, basking in all that glory. He says, you know, we should stay. We should go camping. Maybe build some dwelling places so we can hang out for a while. These days, he'd probably park an RV there. He loves this mountaintop experience, and he wants it to last. Most people do. Those moments of glory where we sense God's presence with us are so powerful, we wish we could always have them. But even as Peter's talking, a cloud comes and overshadows them, and they're terrified. Because in those days, a cloud means God. God is showing up, and the cloud covers them. They are in the cloud, and they hear the voice of God saying, this is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. And then just like that, the Transfiguration is all over. Moses and Elijah disappear, and they go back down the mountain to serve, to go do exorcisms right away. So even this beautiful moment of God's glory is interrupted by the pressing need of the people down the mountain. The whole God's voice coming out of a cloud, doesn't that remind you of the baptism story? Our lectionary places them at the beginning and end of Epiphany like bookends, both of them revealing to us that Jesus is no ordinary rabbi. Jesus is the Son of God. He has this divine identity. And we heard this at the baptism. The voice from the cloud says, you are my son, the beloved. With you I am well pleased. And then this time, the Transfiguration, the voice says to the other standing there, this is my son, my chosen. Listen to him. And like the disciples, you've probably had Transfiguration moments of your own. As I mentioned earlier, where you have touched the glory of Jesus and been transformed. So how do we respond to these experiences? How does it help us, especially in times of trouble, to put our faith in God's Son and to truly listen to him? And speaking of listening, it's possible you've not been listening to my sermon at all this morning because your mind is on the Ukraine. After last week's invasion by Russia and all that they have been going through, they have really been going through an exodus of their own. The last I checked, 350,000 people have already fled Ukraine, pouring over the borders into the other countries. I heard one expert this week say there will probably be 5 million Ukrainians that become refugees before this is over. We don't know how this is going to impact the world or any of us. And so we're afraid. We are very rightly afraid. Are we on the precipice of a world war in a nuclear age, being live broadcast on social media, We have never been in this position like this before. Jesus, the Savior of the world, we're probably saying, where are you? How do we listen to Jesus as God tells us to when in times like this, we might even wonder if Jesus is here at all, if he's listening, if he has the power to save our world. This reminds me of the Hill of Crosses in Lithuania. My family and I visited there with my parents and my husband a few years back. Now, Lithuania is a Baltic country that was at one time under Russian rule. It became part of the Soviet Union against their will. And so religion was then forbidden by the Soviets. And yet, the faith of the Lithuanian people could not be stopped. After one particular uprising against Russian rule, many people were killed. And the families were distraught. They didn't even have bodies to bury. So they created a spot to remember them on a hill. And they placed wooden crosses there and remembered their dead. Now, this was illegal, of course. So the Russians came and plowed down all of the grave markers. Just leveled it. And yet, it still could not stop the faith. Those people started sneaking back to the hill and putting more crosses up. And more crosses, people who hadn't even lost loved ones said, you know, we're not going to be stopped. They can't tell us we can't have Christ. And they just kept coming back and putting more crosses there. They even put mounted KGB soldiers to guard the hill so nobody could put crosses there, and they managed to do it anyway. At least another time, all the crosses were bulldozed by the Russians. And when they finally obtained their independence in 1991, you can believe it, more crosses showed up. And in fact, it started to become a pilgrimage site all around the world. Christians continue to this day to come to the Hill of Crosses. They estimate there's probably 200,000 crosses on this hill representing the faith. I was so astonished to be there because, you know, it's this hill of crosses, and there are crosses upon crosses, and little rosaries, and more crosses, and you walk through it, and there's more crosses, and walk through it, and more crosses, and crosses, and crosses, and crosses. It just seems endless. And we stopped, and we looked at each cross and said, you know, each one of these crosses represents someone's story. Who had faith in Jesus? Who put it there? How far did they come to put it there and stake their claim that Christ is the one in whom I hope? And so many people come to the Hill of Crosses to remember the great pain that the Lithuanians went through, but also to be inspired by them and to think, where is Jesus today? And how is he God's son, the beloved, that we should listen to? And our hearts just ache for the Ukrainians right now as they mourn their dead. As right now they are huddled in makeshift bomb shelters, as some are on foot with nothing but the clothes on their back, fleeing for safety. And we fear for the country of the Ukraine, and we fear for the entire world. How can we come to their aid, but also be advocates for peace? We don't know. We absolutely don't know. But the one thing I can proclaim to you today is that listening to Jesus is more important right now than ever. And this ancient story of the Transfiguration tells us that God is with us. Always, always with us. The God of freedom. The God who wants liberation for everyone, who wants oppression to cease. This God surrounds us with this fierce and deathless love that cannot be stopped. And this God leads us through the wilderness, even through the valley of the shadow of death. And no matter how dark this world, we are led by the light of Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. And our faith, my friends, our faith cannot be quenched. Still, our hope will rise. We believe in the God of resurrection. And so as we head down the mountain with Jesus and enter the season of Lent in a season of war, let us trust in the love of our Savior. And for God's sake, listen to him.
Amen. Now may the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in Christ our Savior. Amen.
Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On this day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Spirit of the Lord is poured out upon us in abundance, so we are bold to pray for the church, the world, and all that God has made. Transform us by your greatness, O God. Send us down the mountain to share joy with all people. Make us agents of change, confident that your hope will vanquish despair and your goodness will conquer evil. God of grace, hear our prayer. The mountains and valleys sing your praise. Dazzle us with your presence in every landscape, bluffs built by ancient glaciers, canyons carved by flowing rivers, flat horizons with uninterrupted views, and sands shaped by ocean tides. God of grace, hear our prayer. You love justice and establish equity. Strengthen leaders of local governments, community, nonprofits, and grassroots campaigns. Bless them with gifts of integrity, creativity, and sound conscience. Build up safe and joyful communities where all people may thrive. God of grace, hear our prayer. Heal those who are in distress, especially the people of Ukraine. Help them, Lord, deliver them, and keep our world at peace. Give patience to those who are waiting for answers. Grant hope to those who have reached the limits of treatment. Give compassionate hearts to those who accompany loved ones through illness and uncertainty. God of grace, hear our prayer. Today we shout Alleluia from the mountaintop. This week we enter the wilderness of Lent. Bless all who prepare and lead us in worship during this change of season. Pastors, musicians, and all who contribute to our worship life. God of grace, hear our prayer. Blessed are they who listen to Christ's voice in this life and now rest with him. Transform us from glory into glory and give us your peace that we may not lose heart. God of grace, hear our prayer. Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Thanks be to God.